be here, the pleasure. Partly because the publisher, my publisher, is based in Manchester. I'll read an introduction which I prepared for the launch of the book, part of the introduction. That way I won't have to feel I need to introduce each poem, which is so short anyway, and they've so revised over the years, it's practically one long poem and no special chronology. So this is part of an introductory note. I wrote this text last night as an introduction in order not to clutter up the reading. It was written on the whiskey and may need revision if it is ever published. An open book flaunting the secret is how I describe a painting by Haley Becker in the prose poem Screen Memory in the book. It has been pointed out to me by an American reader who doubles as a psychoanalyst and poet that this applies to my poems, although there are more than one secret there. If any poem speaks to you or you, it is because you recognize a structure of experience, a structure of the mind, a structure of feeling, a structure of relationship, the experience of experience, the experience of understanding, rather than the understanding of experience, which is the work of other disciplines, psychoanalytic theory, social anthropology, figurative painting, philosophy and fiction, whether psychological or social, but especially phenomenological. A lyric poem is a subversive time capsule. It taps into the overlapping circles of fluidity of reception, which constitute experience of the world. It tunes into the poem of being, which is my life, or a persona's life, or a friend's life. And this radical disturbance generates a poem, or rather a meta-poem, held in place and time by certain techniques, e.g. the pun, which of course is a condensed rhyme, and deliberated syntax, which can be read two ways, and tone, which in my case is said to be austere. All poems are meta-poems. The meta-poem keeps warm through the company of love poems and paintings and philosophical writings by others. The act of writing seems to create the meaning that supposedly created it in the first place. It is briefly an act of supreme attention, like a prayer or a painting. The poem's accidents waiting not to happen, but they do happen on the edge of my other writings, and then years and decades later they are revised, that is, cut and slimmed down. Almost nothing is as it was in the beginning. It was all written today, despite the days. All my life I worked against a certain grade of expectation, which years later I realized had been projected through cowardice and not forced upon me. If I had pushed at the door earlier, I would have found it was not locked, as both Wittgenstein and Kafka tell us. Well, you may be none the wiser. I'm certainly not. Where's the list? Two new poems, which... One is called Card Players, a painting by Baltus. Mesdames, Messieurs, the empty chair awaits you. First come, first served, to your left a trickster card sharp, to your right a fortune teller of the past, lying ahead of you like a dream, a store of menace, bought into like a Ponzi scheme. Watch your back. Baltus invites you to a game of cards. Baltus invites you to share his secret, become a member of the wedding. Sorry, become a member of the painting. That's the title of a book by someone else. Become his double, hypocrite viewer, peddler of illusion. Iron enters the soul of the real at last as you wake to the knowledge, like a cab driver, that Baltus, Count Baltazar Klosowski the Roller, holds all the cards in all the streets, in all the passageways, in all the arcades. Fardo for Paula. Plane trees expire on the avenue. And no dogs bark. Fardo singers embrace in a tavern, and the sea is dying. I hold you tight and I feel the beat of your heart. I give you red wine and a book. Roses are brought to your senses. Songs drift over like dunes. You keep to the shoreline. And now, the prose poem I referred to about containing the phrase about the secret. Screen memory. Heidi Becker's flower paintings, not least the one I have in my sights, always disturb what Duchamp called dismissively the retinal aspect. There is more to her imbricated pattern making than meets the already enchanted eye. Her lives are not so still, her nature's not so mocked. This painting is an open book flaunting a secret. The pale blue book on the table proposes a story which is unfolding behind the scene, symbolically confirmed by the smiling formal, unsmiling formal screen serving as backdrop or backcloth. The flowers seem to be, or perhaps are, embroidered on the screen, a screen memory. The adjacent book does not contain the secret, it participates in the secret. The solid jug, the plain book, the equally plain table surface, foreground and stabilize the troubled, quivery screen and flowers, giving us a perspective for meditation on the story. Becker's flower paintings subvert their own decorative aspects thanks to an ominous inwardness, a painterly walk on the shadow side. She does not only make designs, her work has designs of the viewer, who is, as it were, an intro-viewer. She employs absence as a trope. The flowers allude to a hurt in the psyche, in the soul of all who live life to the full. These flowers are a synecdoche for death, such as Gertrude uses in her famous speech to Ophelia. In the present work, this is not the death of the body, but a kind of spiritual death. In a far recessive evening, a woman has been mourning the end of love, itself perhaps a dream in the first place. The invisible time of the flowers is an aboriginal songline of love, a dream of love which the woman will survive when she emerges at the end of her journey after a long winter, as charted in Schubert's Winterreise. For the dream had been well and truly lived, in work and thought, in love and sex, in poetry and music, until her mad lover, a holy fool, went off the rails at South Station in Budapest or Atocha Station in Madrid. Yes, story there has been, indeed is. Heidi Becker knows something, and when you know something, you know something else. Obsession, a structure. Uninvited, it pounds inside my head. Wrong moves collide, they crack me up like sticks. Compressed, the scream is knotted in my brow. The stone in my head kicks like an unborn baby, bends the mind, drags me like a ball and chain, dead weight, slow death. I sharpen perpetual labour. Oh, to push it out once and for all, then I'll have a feast of deliverance. Throw off my ball and chain and dance. I fool myself that all is possible. The sound of the land, reflection. And there's an epigraph. One must have a mind of winter, one assumes. One, through myself I see across the road a woman's head in an upper window. Such glamour. That upstairs light in a distant land of the mind's eye, shadow flickers like a trembling hand. Two, the hand moves into the air behind the window, spreads itself in a mysterious delirium of caresses. I play the piano, flow into a remembered sweetness. My hands tremble, wrong notes slice the window as if summoned by that other hand behind the window. Three, you are late tonight, maybe you won't come. I hang suspended or I walk the waters of the night, and you, an apparition, merge with my reflection on the square. In little death, let me strike out a longer tangent of oblivion, serene as stone. You are late tonight, maybe you won't come. Four, storm hits the roof, anger is in the air. I hear a baby scream through the rain. Has lightning electrocuting the black cat in the square my house gives on to. Dimension. I live on edge, on edge. I balance on a pebble. I summon a mirage, connection lost and lost again. Shadows curve across the half-light of your no-woman's land, as in a black-and-white movie about a mausoleum of remembrance. Invisible ink. We have lost our voices. Silence is the deepest structure of them all. If you write me a letter in invisible ink, I shall know how to read between the lines. We shall look upon each other. Liminal. Evening of the Rose, in memoriam Paul Celar. Let the exiles in Gara, the worms come home, a memorial prayer to a place and a name. As he laid his head on Shulamit's breast, the unbecoming dead sang him to his rest. 6:30 p.m. on the dot. This is dedicated to Octavio Paz, the Mexican poet, London 1971. Only reached 1971. 10 seconds later, this word in italics leaves the ink extension of my hand, enters the page a great distance from the darkness the word began in. I borrow from you stone, move on to sun, and recall your poem which comes full circle, forever arriving. I break through the circle, return to my own words. Saint Paul de Vence. Once more I name the city where the stone inspired a life inspired the stone. It was a place whose moral shape and moulds of commonwealth, quote unquote, revealed themselves within its walls of refuge, where a life was lived, not happiness pursued, though peaceable you died, assured of continuity. Now it is thanks to commerce that the old place survives, and thanks to commerce will die tomorrow. Why complain of that, since this reprieve is afterlife? The ancient city yields the time before a poem. Our house is always open to the sun, beating on a wall. It is a time of signs. Zed Kotowitz reading Bachelard on a train. Kotowitz is a philosopher who died last year. Bachelard, of course, you know, the reverie, the poetics of reverie, the poetics of space, the poetics of fire. Half awake in the empty carriage, he always sets his jacket alight with a cigarette. Half asleep, he sees in the window someone swift, nervous, striking him. Ah, it is he himself on the other side, gesturing in the twilight. The tiny flame pinpoints a space for reverie. This is a translation to sort of nod in the direction of all those translations I've done. It's the last poem that Karl Kraus wrote. And it's the last line of this poem. You know who he was, the great Viennese satirist. And he's talking about what was happening in Austria and Germany just in 36 or 7. Don't ask what I've been doing all the time. I hold my tongue and I shan't say why. And there is a stillness when the earth cracks. No word fitted. I speak only in my sleep and dream of a laughing sun. This too will pass. Afterwards it makes no difference. The word passed away when that world woke up. Found poem. It has a Hasidic epigraph. Never celebrate the truth in the place where you find it, because it is no longer there. At the time I knew I'd lost it. I did not buy the book about Morandi, which I hoped would trigger the poem that would go with others, written on the subject of my reaction to a painter loved. I'd been mean, it cost me dear and served me right. Example of not yielding to impulse. That poem was lost forever. Now this one, which I found by chance in MoMA's bookshop while looking for a book on Kitai, shortly after realizing Reinhardt's black touches on the blue of Klein, gives me pause for thought. It's poems written that are lost forever. Unwritten ones always remain to be found, like Morandi, painting variations on the same theme. It has taken me 20 years to get the picture. I think I've got some time left, haven't I? Yes. I want to read quite a long prose poem. It's called Europe, it's the title poem of the book, and it's called European Hours, Invocations. It's an account of my travels with somebody, the person who painted the cover of the book. And each city visited is described. Apart from the first two, each section commemorates a single visit. But the first two, Lisbon and London, are kind of, what's the word I'm looking for, combos of, well, obviously London, since I live there, we live there. Lisbon, to your azulejos tiles, commissioned by the Marquis of Frontera for the garden of his palacio. To St. Vincent's panels by Nuno Gonçalves and Bosch's triptych, The Temptation of St. Anthony, in the Museo Nacional de Arte Antigua. To your paintings in the chapel of the President's Palace of Belém, and to a house of stories 20 miles away, London. To Piero de Cosimo's battle between the Lapids and the Centaurs in the National Gallery, a favourite painting, a favourite picture you always study closely. To your studio and its contents, mannequins, costumes and masks, pastels, pencils and charcoal slates, tubes of acrylics, traditional oil paint and water mixable oil. To the music in your studio, Amalia, Maritza and Camané, Munuji, Montan and Patachou, Rigoletto, La Traviata and Carmen. To Kubla Khan, for he on whom you had fed and drunk the love of paradise, always read aloud after dinner with you joining in from my old and battered Gorbachev's book of living verse, which my father bought me at the Festival of Britain in 1951. Paris, to Géricault's Raft of the Medusa in the Louvre, you would like to do a picture that size. The figure there, face down, Delacroix was the model, I said. He was influenced, inspired by Géricault, you reply. Which word did you use? Maybe both. To the art of Victor Hugo, seen in his house, 6 Place des Vosges, you praise the drawings and sketches. To the paintings and books in the apartment of the poet and the painter, Rue Lepic. To Raymond Mason's sculptures, The Crowd, in the Tuileries, and the expulsion of fruit and vegetables from the heart of Paris, February the 28th, 1969. In Saint-Eustache Church, Leal. Lake Orta, to the life-size terracotta and wooden figures on the Sacro Monte. Venice, to Titian's Pietà in the Accademia, his final painting, you examine it closely. To the Tiepolo fresco, here begins modern art, says Raymond Mason, met by chance in the very room. In Cara Zenit, wrote Bezonico, the palazzo where Robert Browning lived, and Cole Porter stayed, and where visits by Henry James to Browning inspired the private life. To the graves of 3 Russians, Stravinsky, Diaghilev, Brodsky, on San Michele, you light a candle for your mother in a small chapel. To the glass blowers of Murano, Florence, to Donatello's penitent mandolin in Museo dell'Opera del Duomo, to Masaccio, Valcarci Chapel in the late afternoon, to Rilke, Poltrano, to Dostoevsky and the Brownings, whose apartments are close to the Pitti Palace. Zurich, to Valentin's interior with the woman in red and other paintings in the Kunsthaus. Maybe he influenced Popper, you say. To the work of a mask maker in a village half an hour from the city. You buy one of his masks, now a stalwart prop in the studio. Basel, to Holbein's dead Christ in the Kunsthaus. Prince Michigan in the Iliad, a man's faith might be ruined by that picture. Discussing Dostoevsky on the plane back to Zurich, for you his best novel is the Iliad, for me Brothers Karamazov. Vienna, to Don Carlos of the Opera House, your memories of the box at the Lisbon Opera House, where you saw Rigoletto, La Traviata and Carmen, and many other operas with your father. To the merry widow of the Volkstheater, and the coffee houses, their ghosts, Josef Holt, Freud, Mahler, Arthur Schnitzler, Hoffmannsthal, Stefan Zweig, Karl Krauss. To the Venus of Willendorf at the Natural History Museum and Franz Xaver Messerschmidt in the Belvedere. To the Albertina, world famous for its drawings and prints, closed for refurbishment. Madrid, to Velázquez. to Goya's black paintings and Yves Bonfoy's book on the artist, to the paintings of José de Ribera in the Academia, an artist you want me to discover, to Salvador Dali, whom you taught me out of disrespecting, taught me into appreciating, Valladolid, to the museum of painted wooden sculptures which you love, Burgos, to the monastery of alabasters near the cathedral with the vast Tumbleveld Sea, Barcelona, to the early work of Picasso and Miro, to silent thoughts about the early work of other great and lifelong painters. Antwerp, to the grotesque paintings and drawings by Goya, Redon, and Ensor, exhibited in the Museum of Fine Arts. To the lace you buy in a shop near the cathedral with its enormous Rubens triptych, lace folded neatly in the studio after use. Munich, to lamentation over the dead Christ, Botticelli's Pietà in the Alta Pinacotec. The way you give this troubled and anxious, intense and frightening picture your full attention. Colmar, to Matthias Grunwald's Isenheim altarpiece, to Martin Schongauer's Madonna of the Rose Garden in the Church of the Dominicans. We wander to a dark and empty chapel where your eye is caught by an obscure ostensory with two angels. You take out your pencil and sketchbook. I forgot to read the little sort of epigraph which I wrote. To ancestral Europe, your Iberia, my Austria-Hungary, to London. One more poem. try to find one which is not about a painting. There are some. This is about the first wife of a painter, of a writer friend of mine, about when she died. In fact, he died recently, Clive Sinclair, you may have read his novels. Franz Sinclair, death is a circle reduced to a point. Eaten alive, Frank can't bear the weight. Only a little longer, wait now. Lighter than air, she hovers, a songbird in her silence. Dark, still, a sated lover. Her sunset places a rose, husband Clive places a rose on the wooden box. Goodbye, he gently packs the box. Gathered by the Shekhinah, Fran is one with flame and rose. The point is, a circle grows, and her bird song is written like a new moon in the sky.